ब्रह्मानंदं परमसुगतं केवलं ज्ञानमूर्तिं द्वन्द्वातीतं गगनसदृशं तत्त्वमस्यादिलक्ष्यं एकं नित्यं विमलमचलं सर्वदी साक्षिभूतं भावादीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तं नमामि।
Welcome you all, my love, respect. Today's subject is being such a miraculous. From the time immemorial, human beings are searching continuously what we call miracles, extraordinary happenings. Almost all the religions, all the spiritual groups, all the spiritual societies are answers for the great happenings in the planet Earth which can't be explained logically. There are so many thousands of things happening which is beyond logic. Whenever anybody tries to explain the things which is beyond logic, he creates a new religion. All our search, all our seeking, all our effort to find solution, to find answer for what is happening beyond our logic, what we call miracles. All our effort to demystify the miracles created new religions, different kinds of spiritual theories, different kind of understanding about these energies. First, let us understand the word miracle. There is nothing on this planet Earth which is miracle actually. Patanjali declares very clearly, the greatest spiritual navigator ever born on the planet Earth. Patanjali is a person who declared first time there is no such thing as miracle happens in the planet Earth. Whatever happens has got clear cause. Cause and effect. If you do not know the cause, then you think it is miracle. You think it is something extraordinary. If you know the cause, you understand this cause and effect. If you do not know the cause, you always think it is miracle. Patanjali is the great spiritual navigator, master who declared everything has got cause and there is nothing called miracle. He demystified the whole science and in a way he made the whole spirituality as a science, which is possible in everyone's life. By nature, man has got inquisitiveness, the curiosity to search in extraordinary things. That is why from the time immemorial, again and again, we are searching something extraordinary, something supernatural. We don't keep quiet, just living the basic life. We want something more, something more, something more. So we search what is happening, what is happening in the planet Earth, what is happening in the sky, what is happening beyond. The search for the miracles continues. Patanjali is a first rishi who declared, who opened all the secrets, who opened all the truths. He makes it as a science, which way, through which technique you can achieve which miraculous powers. First thing, he guides the people to achieve miracle powers. Next thing, he teaches whatever is happening is miracle. He gives a two kind of solutions for life. First he gives the techniques to achieve all the miracles. Next, he teaches what the technique to see everything as miracle. According to me, there is only two kind of lifestyle. One is living as though nothing is miracle, or as though everything is miracle. There is only two kind of lifestyle. For both lifestyle, Patanjali gives methods. He illumines a new path for human beings to travel. He shows a new way, and he demystifies whatever we call as miracles. Step by step, he explains the different kind of miracles and how those energies can be achieved, how you can penetrate. Now, I wanted to analyze one or two things. Search for miracles, is it going to help us? First, let us analyze. Searching for these miracles, is it going to help us in our practical day-to-day life? In a way, it can create inquisitiveness, it can create curiosity, it can give you the idea there is something beyond what you see with the five senses. It can give you an inspiration that there is something more than what you see on the planet Earth. As an inspiration to search the extraordinary thing, it is surely a big help. But just searching for miracles itself is no way going to help you. As a starting step, it can be a big inspiration to go towards the higher dimensions of life. That is what Patanjali says. When you start searching for miracles, when you start searching for extraordinary things, naturally you understand there is one more dimension for your life. There is something more in your life than what you understand. But slowly, 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 you come to a clear understanding, you come to a clarity, you come to a realization that even miracles are not enough. You need to go beyond the miracles. I always tell people, there are two things. One is Shakti to make your dreams into reality. That is what is miracle powers. Miracle power means You will have power to make your dreams into reality. That is Shakti. That's next thing, Buddhi, means realizing whatever is reality is nothing but your dream. Making your dreams into reality is Shakti. Realizing that your reality is nothing but dream is Buddhi, intelligence. If your search for Shakti leads you to Buddhi, then it is right. If your search for miracles, if it leads you to experience whatever is happening is a miracle, then your search is right. But if your search stops just in few miracle powers, you miss the real miracle, which is universe, which is existence. The greatest miracle is realizing the whole universe in your being, or your being in the whole universe. When you travel in your search of the miracles, when you start in your path, step by step you come upon few miracle powers. If your energy is getting solidified, in the second step you get the power of intuition. Intuition means seeing the things before it happens. People ask me, Swamiji, how can we see the things before it happens? It is just against the logic. It is just against the logic. How can we see before things happen? It is not against the logic. Because whatever you think as past or future is nothing but the projection of present. Now there is a new thing which is going on in the among the physics scientists, a new talk, parallel universe. If black hole happens in some place, in some other corner of the universe, Big Bang happens. Big Bang and black hole, they continuously happen parallelly. Continuously somewhere black hole is happening, and the parallel side of the universe, the other side, same way Big Bang is happening. If the Big Bangs are happening, black holes are happening. When you don't know the connection, you think it is a two independent incident. If you understand the connection, you will understand it is not two separate incidences. It is just cause and effect, that's all. They say even a single atom cannot move without creating effect in the other side of the universe. If an atom moves in a place, the other side, parallelly, another atom moves. If you understand this parallel universe theory, you will be able to understand your future and past are not two independent things. They are just deeply related with the present. Understand the time as a shaft. Actually, time is a shaft. One side is past incidences, other side is future incidences. Center present. You never touch the time shaft actually. You are always pulled in the past or by the future. You always live in the past or live in the future. You never touch the present moment. Present moment is the time through which you can touch this time shaft. Eternity is past, present and future. All the three is eternity. But you can touch the eternity only in the present moment. If you are in the present moment, only then you can touch the eternity. If you touch the eternity, you can understand the past and future are not different from present. They are just extensions of present. From the past moment, this moment is taking birth. From this moment, next moment is taking birth. If you have the glimpse at least once of the present moment, if you live even for one moment in the present moment, you will have a clear glimpse, clear idea about the future. Just yesterday in the Shakti Spurana program, one devotee questioned me, "Swamiji, sometimes I feel when I am in a party, suddenly I feel the same party has happened in my life. I have been to the same house already once and I feel suddenly the same incident is happening. And I feel in 5 minutes somebody is going to come or some incident is going to happen. Exactly in 5 minutes the same thing will happen. How this happens? Is it happening only in my life or in everybody's life? How I am feeling like this?" Then I asked, there were 80 people. I asked, "How many of you experienced the same thing in some time of your life, one or other time of your life?" You will be surprised. More than 70% of the people raised their hands. And they say, "All of us had this experience in some time in our life. If you enter into some house, suddenly you feel, I have come to the same house. And you know which side which room is. And you straight go there." The same incident. Yesterday I was surprised. In the 80 people, majority of the people had this experience in their life at least more than once. When you experience the present moment at least once, by mistake, actually by mistake only we fall in the present. We never enter into present consciously. Because if you enter into present consciously, you will never move out of the present moment. You, by mistake, sometimes you suddenly fall into present moment. Your consciousness drops into present moment. You have nothing to bother, nothing to worry, or nothing to think. In those moments only, you feel the glimpse of the future and you feel the same thing has happened already. In that moment, you touch the time shaft. You experience the glimpse of the time shaft. When you touch the time shaft, you experience the whole universe is nothing but the projection from present moment. Your past and your future is not two independent things. It is just deeply dependent on your present moment. You will understand the bridge between your past and future, but we always miss. We always miss. We always miss the present moment. And not only that, not only we miss the present moment, we miss actual problem. Why we miss the present moment? We never look into the present moment. We always find, we try to find solution to wrong method. A small story. One American guy was traveling in London with a British gentleman and British lady. Both of them were sitting next to him in the train. The lady had a pet dog. Suddenly the dog jumped on him and pissed. Made the whole area mess, dirty. Instead of apologizing, this British lady, she started patting the dog. "Oh, you have cold bladder. I should take care of you. I should do something to you." After a few minutes, this dog jumped again on the American guy and vomited. Again, this lady, instead of apologizing, she started patting the dog. Oh, I should take you to the doctor immediately. You have some serious stomach trouble. After 5 minutes, again the dog jumped on him, and now you know what it would have done. It has done whatever it can do. Again, this lady, instead of apologizing, she started patting the dog. Now it is too much. The American guy simply got up, picked the dog, threw it out of the window. Simply threw it out of the window. Till this moment, the gentleman, British gentleman, was keeping quiet. Now he started talking. You American guys, driving the wrong side, measure with the wrong scale, now threw the wrong bitch out of the window. You always throw the wrong bitch out of the window. We always try to find solutions by throwing the wrong bitch out of the window. In our life, whenever you find trouble in the past or in the future, you try to work by trying to alter the past or by trying to work, develop on the future. But you cannot do both because both are not in your hands. You can't do anything about the past. It's already over. You can't do anything about the future because it has not yet happened. You can do anything only in the present moment. But you never do anything related to the present moment. Doing something which is related to present moment is what I call meditation. Meditation does not mean you will close your eyes and sit silently, chant some mantra. No, that is also one kind of meditation. But if you try to touch the present moment by any method, that is meditation. Any technique, any method which brings you to the present moment is meditation. If eating can bring you to the present moment, if you can eat staying in the present moment, that can become meditation. Simply walking, if it can bring you to the present moment, if you can be in the present moment when you walk, walking is meditation. Just sitting, if you can bring yourself to the present moment, it is meditation. Anything which brings you to the present moment only can solve your problems. But we always throw wrong pitch out of the window. Again and again we miss the right pitch. In your life, when you fall into the present moment by mistake, you always fall in the present moment only by mistake. If you fall, you get the power of intuition. Whenever you feel, suddenly same incident happens. Next, this is what is going to happen. And if it happens, be very clear. You touched the time shaft. Actually, if you can touch the time shaft more than 21 shana. Shana means not second. It is not second. In Vedic system, time is calculated psychologically, not chronologically. There is two kind of times. One is chronological time, what west follows. Another one is psychological time, what east follows. Shana does not mean second. Please be very clear. Shana means the gap between one thought and the other thought. Shana means gap between one thought and the other thought. Let me explain the difference between psychological time and chronological time. Sometimes when you sit with somebody whom you really love and whose company you enjoy, you do not even know that 5 hours has gone. You do not even know how the time is flying. If you sit with somebody, you feel bored or disturbed, who tortures you. Even 10 minutes will not move. You will feel even 10 minutes is an eternity. People say the eternal hell. Why? Because in the hell never time moves. In the hell never time moves. The number of thoughts, if it becomes more, you feel time is not moving. If the number of thoughts becomes less, you will realize time is flying. So in the East, we always measure time based on the mental setup. Based on the mental setup, that is why we always tell, for the higher level jivas, for devatas, our 1 year is 1 day for them. The 1 year of human beings is 1 day for devatas. Means the number of thought is very less. If the number of thoughts are very less, you will be in heaven. Please be very clear, heaven and hell are not geographical. If it is geographical, we would have sent every satellite. No, it is not geographical, it is psychological. The more number of thoughts, you are in hell. Less number of thoughts, you are in heaven. It is by number of thoughts we measure whether we are in hell or in heaven. It is the psychological time which decides whether you are in hell or heaven. If time flies, if you are enjoying, you are in heaven. If the time is not at all moving, it is just stagnant, you feel bored, then you are in hell. It is just a psychological setup, not chronological. If you can hold the time shaft just for 21 minutes, just for 21 chana, not even minutes, 21 chana. The word minute cannot be the right translation of word chana, because the very meaning itself is different. If you can penetrate the time shaft consciously, 21 chana, you will know your whole future. You will know your whole future. Just 21 chana is more than enough to know the whole future, but we never penetrate the present moment. We never allow ourselves in the present moment. The morning, if you are brushing your teeth, you will be thinking of your office. If you are in the office, you will be thinking of evening going to the beach. If you are in the beach, you will be already planning when to go back to the house. If you are in the house, again you will start planning about next day work. If you are here, you can be sure you are not here. If you are here, one thing is sure, you are not here. You always escape from the present moment. Even if you don't have any worries to worry, even if you can't get any reason to worry, you just start planning for future. And I have seen people, if they don't find any reason to worry, they try their best to catch some reason. And if they can't find, the next step is, today everything is going well, Swamiji, I don't know what will happen tomorrow. And we always believe very strongly, if today things go well, tomorrow something bad is going to happen. Something worst is going to happen. This very thought, tomorrow something worst is going to happen, you are waiting for the worst thing to happen. You are practically meditating for the worst thing to happen. You are literally waiting to get hurt. When you beg to get hurt, naturally God graces you. When you wait to get hurt, naturally He graces you. No other way. Otherwise, you find some reason and hurt yourself. When you don't have any past things to worry, you start creating something in the future to worry, to create. You never touch the present moment. You never penetrate the time shaft. That is why you never get a glimpse of the past or the future. When you touch the present, you experience the intuition power. In the next level, when your being becomes little more solid, in the next level of energy, you get a next power which we call Siddhi, which we call the next Siddhi. The next Siddhi is altering the future. Understand, the first level Siddhi is knowing the future. In the first level Siddhi, you can only know the future. The next level experience, you get the power of altering the future. How this happens? How can we change the future? Yesterday a devotee was asking, Swamiji, if there is a future, how can we change the future? If there is a free will, where is the destiny? If there is a destiny, where is the free will? Understand one example. There is a beautiful example by Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. He says, it's like a cow tied on a post. The rope length is 5 meter. Inside the 5 meter, cow has got free will. It can sit, stand, go around, do whatever it wants. But more than 5 meter, the cow cannot go. Beyond the 5 meter, it is destiny. But inside the 5 meter, it has got clear free will. If the cow behaves properly, if the cow doesn't do anything wrong, the cow lives properly, silently, not disturbing anybody, there is every chance the owner will extend the length of the rope or free the cow totally. Same way, the free will which is given to you, if it is handled properly, if it is used properly, if you don't use it to hurt others or to hurt yourself, please understand, not only hurting others, even hurting yourself is a sin. When you continuously worry, you are hurting yourself. There is an Upanishad Sutra, Anandam Brahmedi Navya Janat. Ananda, the bliss, is existence. Don't waste it. We are wasting our life without living the natural bliss, which is our nature. Every moment which you spend, which you live without being blissful, is wasting your life and a deep disrespect to your life. Life itself is just a bliss. The very nature of life is joy and bliss. Every moment you spend in suffering is a disrespect to the life. Please be very clear. A real puja, a real worship is living joyfully and blissfully. Somebody came and asked me, Swamiji, in my house there is no peace. Please give me some technique, some method to bring peace. I told her, first thing, all of you sit together, eat together, spend time, laugh, dance. Naturally, you will see, you will have more understanding. This bliss, this joy will bring more and more peace. Don't find fault with each other continuously. Just try to be blissful. She said, no, Swamiji. Teach me some technique, some puja, which can help, which can bring peace in my house. Puja can bring when it is done honestly and spiritually. That is true. She asked, no, teach me some puja. Should I do Saundari Lakshmi or Griha Lakshmi? Which puja to bring peace? She is not ready to listen to the solution. Then I said, what generally you do when you go inside the puja room? You do puja to Lakshmi. When you come out, archana to husband. How will the peace come? How will you have the peace? It is a life solution which you need to follow more than any other ritual. The greatest puja is how to be blissful, how to be more joyful. Every moment which you spent in worrying and suffering is disrespect to the life and God, because He is the person who gave you the life. If you disrespect a rose, the person who gave you the rose, you disrespect Him also, naturally. When you disrespect a bunch of rose, naturally you disrespect a person who gave you the rose. So when you don't live with bliss, naturally you disrespect the divine. Life is too valuable to be spent in suffering and misunderstanding. When you don't hurt yourself and hurt others, there is every chance the rope length can be extended from 5 meter to 10, or you can be liberated. The persons who are liberated are only called as Jivan Muktas. When you actually live in the present moment, you can never hurt yourself or you can never hurt others. When you live in the present moment, your being feels so much filled with the life. You will be flowering, you will be overflowing with so much of energy. You can never hurt others, you can never hurt yourself. All disturbances to yourself, to others, happens only in unconscious level. As long as you are unconscious, you will hurt others and you will hurt yourself. The moment you become conscious of what is happening inside your being, naturally you will stop hurting yourself and you will stop hurting others. Masochism and sadism is one and the same. If you hurt yourself, naturally you will hurt others. If you hurt others, naturally you will hurt yourself. Because you have only one mind, you don't have two mind. You have only one mind. It's like a double-edged sword. If you kill others, you will naturally commit suicide. If you try to commit suicide, you will naturally kill others. It is a double-edged sword. When you come to the present moment, when you start living in the present moment, you will see a new dimension of your being opens. You experience the new taste, new space of your being. When you experience the new space of your being, your past stops binding you. Your future starts listening to you. As long as your past binds you, your future will never listen to you. People come and ask me, "Swamiji, I want to stop smoking. Please tell me something." I tell them, first thing you have to do is drop the guilt. They get surprised. They tell me, "What is this, Swamiji? If I drop my guilt, I will start smoking more. What are you talking? You say drop my guilt." No. Only when you drop your guilt, only when you are free from your past. Guilt is from past. Only when you are free from your past, you will have enough of energy to change your future. As long as you carry the guilt, you will project only your past into future. Understand? When you carry the guilt, you already decide you can't change your future. If you have the confidence that you can change your future, you will not carry the guilt. The moment you carry the guilt, you decide, you take it for granted, "I can't change my future, I am going to go only in this way." That is why you carry the guilt. There is a beautiful character described in Ramayana, Vali. The story says, anybody who faces the Vali will lose half of their power, and the half of the power will go to the Vali. If you stand in front of him to oppose him, half of your power will go to Vali. Same way, if you stand in front of your past to fight with him, half of your power will go to him. Your guilt will suck half of your energy. Understand? All your negativity has got only one power, which is supplied by you by having faith on that negativity. That's all. All your negativity has got only one power, that is supplied by you by having faith on that negativity. When you decide, I have to fight to drop my smoking, you give power to smoking to fight with you. You give half of your power, then you start fighting. It's almost like you fight with your shadow. You will never win. You will never win. Again and again you can see, the deeper the guilt, you will commit the same mistake again. The more strongly you take the vow, I will not become angry next time, more you will become mad. The more stronger the vow, more madness. The more strongly you decide, I will stop smoking, more quickly you will pick up in your hands. Because the thought is there continuously. You will project your past into the future continuously. As long as you try to fight with your past, you are in unconsciousness, and you will project the same past into the future. Be very clear. More the guilt, same mistake. You can see, by guilt you will never be able to overcome any mistake. Any mistake you can never overcome by guilt. Because when you are having the guilt, you are under the clutches of the past. So naturally, future will not listen to you. Future will not listen to you. Drop from the past. Come to the present moment. Come to the present moment. When you come to the present moment, naturally you will see your future is available to you. Your future is available to you. As long as you live based on the past, naturally you will see the past will automatically penetrate the future. Instead of you living the future, past will be living the future. Past will be living the future. A small thing you understand, a very simple thing. It is from this moment, next moment takes birth. If you believe in this moment that you can't drop some habit because it is past, naturally you can't drop it in the future. So, coming out of the past, coming to the present moment, you will start having a new understanding about the future. You will start having a new realization about the future. One more thing, when you sincerely penetrate the present moment, the eternity, the present moment, the time shaft stops moving. Time shaft stops moving. Somebody asks Buddha, "Buddha, what's your age?" He just remains silent. They ask him again, "Buddha, tell me what's your age?" He says, "What can I say? Eternity is the only word I can say." In the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna declares, the Rajaiti Rajaiti Yoga, Krishna says, "O Arjuna, the same science is delivered by me to Sun God, to Ishvagu, and now to you." Arjuna gets shocked. Arjuna says, "What are you talking? You are just 40 years old, but Sun God and Ishvagu are 5,000 years old. How can you say, you Krishna, you gave this knowledge to Sun God?" Krishna says, "Arjuna, you don't understand what I say. Time shaft never moves when you penetrate the present moment." When Krishna says, "I gave the same science to Sun God," he is not telling the lie, please be very clear. He is telling the truth. When you actually enter into present moment, you just become past, present and future. You experience a different space. The problem is, we have experienced only the horizontal line of the time shaft. Past, present and future. We know only the horizontal line of the time shaft. But if you come to the present, If you just stay in the present moment, you will experience a different dimension, what we call vertical dimension. The vertical dimension, in vertical dimension, there is no time, there is no past, there is no future, it is eternity. That is what we call enlightenment. That is what we call enlightenment. The man who has experienced the past, present and future, the horizontal shaft and the vertical shaft, he is the person who is enlightened. According to me, the cross itself denotes the horizontal shaft and vertical shaft of time. When you die in the horizontal shaft, you resurrect in the vertical shaft. When you die in this horizontal shaft, horizontal space of past, present and future, when you die in this horizontal line, you will experience a vertical line, which is different space, timeless, spaceless zone, what we call as Chidakasha. What we call as Chidakasha in Sanskrit. When you experience that consciousness, that is why again and again our masters declare, it is eternity, it is eternity, it is eternity. All our idea of time and the past and the future is just an idea. It is not reality. When you get even the very small glimpse of present moment, you will understand the future and the past. If you can experience the present moment, the experiencing present moment is what I call meditation. You see, for meditation, you don't need to do anything differently. People come and ask me, Swami, is meditation extraordinary thing? I tell them, according to me, meditation is the most ordinary thing. Nothing else is necessary. If you are aware how you are sitting, how your body is, what you are doing, what you are listening, just the present moment, the awareness of the present moment can lead you to the meditation, can put you into the present moment, can give you the glimpse of vertical space of the time shaft. One glimpse can change your whole life. Just one glimpse. But the difficulty is, because it is so simple, we miss it again and again. If you are asked to do something complicated, you will never miss it. Because anything which is complicated gives ego satisfaction. Anything very complicated gives you the ego satisfaction. I have seen in India people walking from the bottom of the hill to the top of the hill to have the Lord's darshan in Tirupati. In so many hills, people walk uphill, people go around the hills, but they can never sit silently for 10 minutes. Ask them to sit silently, no, they can't sit. You can sit with anybody, you can't sit with yourself. You can sit with anybody, but you can't sit with yourself. Sitting with yourself, what I call meditation. If you can sit with yourself without even having thinking or any words in your mind, you will experience the glimpse of time shaft. When you experience, naturally, the future will be under your control. People come and ask me, Swamiji, can you predict my future? I tell them, I can change your future. Why do you bother about predicting the future? Don't bother about predicting the future. There are thousands of fools sitting and predicting the future continuously. Go to India, under every banyan tree, one guy will be sitting with a parrot. The parrot himself doesn't know about his future. That is why he is under the cage. But you people go and sit there in front of the parrot and ask about your future. And that guy himself don't have a house. He is homeless, sitting under the banyan tree. He will guide you when you will build your house. That is what is predicting the future. Don't bother about predicting the future. Future is actually under your control. When I say, again your mind plays again. Swami speaks nicely, but these are all not practical. I am a grihastha, these are all not for me. He is an enlightened person, he is a Swami, he can talk all these things, this is not for us. You know, your mind knows all cunning methods to escape from present moment. Understand? Just like any being in the planet Earth, your mind has also its own instinct to survive. So it gives enough of confusion, enough of misunderstanding, enough of doubts, so that it can keep you under its control. It can keep you under its control. That is the reason, again and again and again, you are in the clutches of the past or the future. Experience the present, you will experience a different dimension of your being. In the first level, you get the power to see the future. In the next level, you get the power to change the future. In the third level, you understand there is no past and future. In the first, you start seeing the future. In the next, in the intellectual level, you start seeing the future. In the emotional level, you get the power to change the future. That is what I say. Shakti to make your dreams into reality. In the third level, you get the buddhi. The reality itself is the dream. The whole reality is your dream. There is a beautiful story. A great Zen master, an enlightened master, he wakes up from the bed early morning and starts sleeping suddenly. Starts sleeping. Disciples are all surprised. What happened? Master, what happened to you? You are an enlightened person. Enlightened person is not supposed to cry. You cannot cry. What happened to you? Why are you weeping? Master says, no, no. I dreamt as if I became butterfly last night. The disciples asked, what is there in that? After all a dream, forget about it. Now you have become all right. You are here. Why do you bother about dreams? Forget. Drop it. Why are you crying for that? Master says, no, I don't understand whether I dreamt that I became butterfly or that butterfly is now dreaming that it has become a master. Whether I dreamt I became butterfly or that butterfly is dreaming now that it has become master. I do not know. I am not able to understand. That is why I am weeping. Understand one thing, there is no guarantee that you are sitting and listening to my discourse. There is every chance it can be one more dream. There is no scale. People tell me, no, no, Swamiji, I can pinch and see. No, in the dream also you can pinch yourself and say it is not a dream. So there is no guarantee. There is every chance you may be sitting in the dream and listening to my discourses. There is nothing sure that you are in waking state. When your conscious level raises to the third level, to the upper level, you understand whatever is so-called reality is nothing but your dreams. The person who realizes whatever you think as reality is nothing but dream, he is the one we call awakened, the Buddha. Buddha means awakened. There is only two kind of people in the world. One is Buddha, another one is Buddhu. That's all. Either you are Buddha or Buddhu. There is no parallel. Either you are awakened or you are wrapping the darkness. When you experience the present moment, even one glimpse can give you the taste of different space in your being. The taste of different space in your energy. Understand, these are the three levels. When you touch the time shaft just for one glimpse, you get the power to see the future. when you penetrate it little bit, you get the power to change the future. When you penetrate the time shaft totally, you realize the past future idea itself is dream. In search of miracles should lead you to beyond miracles. You can start searching for miracles. Many people come and ask me, Swamiji, we want to do some miracle. It's a usual thing. Anywhere I go, please Swamiji, do some miracle. How much you tell the people, no, doing miracle is nothing. That is not the real thing. Just materializing something or teleporting something is not a real miracle. Transforming the human lives is the greatest miracle. How much you tell, but people again want to watch something. People again want to have something. When you have the craving, when you start mongering for mysteries, you will miss the mystery of mystery, which is God. Please be very clear. When you start searching only for miracles, you miss the greatest miracle, the whole existence. The greatest miracle is existence. If you start searching something, only some small things are miracle. If you start thinking only few things are miracle, you will miss the greatest miracle, which is universe, which is the great existence. Understand, don't miss the great miracle, which is existence, which is universe, the divine. So in search of miracles is good path to start, good place to start, but bad place to end. Right place to start, wrong place to end. So let your search for miracles lead you to the energy which is miraculous itself. Let it lead you to the space where you experience the greatest miracle, the whole existence, the prapancha, the universe. Ramana Maharshi says beautifully, the blood becoming blood in your body is the greatest miracle. But we take all these great miracles for granted and search for something else, search for some other miracles. Understand and look little deeply. Come to the present moment, you will understand the whole universe is nothing but a miracle. The whole universe is the greatest miracle. You will experience the greatest miracle, which we call universe. So let you experience the glimpse of the present moment. Let you experience the glimpse of the present moment in your being, in your space, and let you experience the bliss, eternal bliss, the Nityananda. Thank you.